Okay, guys, why do I believe that the Bible is inspired? Now, inspired can mean several different things. I mean inspired as in God directs it, allows it to be what it is. Now, we know, or you may know, that the Bible has forgeries and corruptions and mistranslations and all that, and people get very frustrated with that. I don't get frustrated. I get frustrated with it sometimes when forgeries are presented to me and I can't demonstrate to someone that it is a forgery because they're ignorant. That's the only thing that frustrates me, the people, not the forgery itself. The forgery doesn't frustrate me because the forgery is there for a purpose. It's there to divide the wheat from the chaff. It's the parable within the parable. That's what it is. Jesus was asked, why do you speak parables? And he said, unto you it is given to know the mysteries of the kingdom of God, but unto them that are without it is not given. So he speaks to them without in parables, but unto them within he speaks plainly and openly about what he's saying. And it's the same thing with the scripture. The scripture is not going to be just right out in the open for you. You're going to have to seek it. You're going to have to search it out. You're going to have to strengthen what remains and find the truth. It's not going to be right in front of you. It's not going to be ready-made. There is no ready-made salvation. This is a conversion. This is something that you are healed from. So the errors and the forgeries and all of that doesn't bother me. It really doesn't. Let me give you an example. Zechariah 12 and 10. I will pour upon the house of David and the inhabitants of Jerusalem the spirit of grace and supplications, and they shall look upon me whom they have pierced, and they shall mourn for him as one that mourneth for his only son, and they shall be in bitterness for him as one bitterness for his firstborn. As you know, Trinitarians, deity Christ believers, present this to try to suggest that the Father is saying that he is Jesus and he is literally the one that was pierced. Now, the scholarship of the matter would be that it's a mistranslation. So that would be a mistranslation. It doesn't say they shall look upon me. It says they shall look upon him. Okay, that's fine. But even with the error, even with the mistranslation, it can still be okay. Now watch, this is crazy. This is how it works, okay? If we go to Matthew 25 and 40, and the king shall answer and say unto them, verily I say unto you, insomuch as you have done it unto the least of these, my brethren, ye have done it unto me. Now Jesus says, if you've done it unto the least of my brethren, you've done it unto me. So if Jesus, something was done unto Jesus, and certainly he is more than the least of God's, then you've done it unto God. So if you've done it unto the least of his brethren, you've done it unto Jesus. And if you've done it unto Jesus, then you've done it unto God. So if you've done it unto anyone in the church, you've done it unto God, because they are God. That all may be God, because God is in all. And that's what Paul said very clearly. So it's okay if it said, they shall look upon me whom they had pierced, and that be God speaking, without believing that Jesus was literally God by the very doctrine that Jesus himself taught. If you learn Jesus' doctrines, now this is why. Now listen very carefully. If you learn Jesus' doctrines, then no forgery, no mistranslation will bring you to a false doctrine. And this is why I believe the Bible is inspired. Because I didn't know about these forgeries and corruptions, and I escaped. I escaped by accepting the teachings of Jesus. Now, let me give you another example. The thief on the cross, what's the general message there? Deathbed salvation. So that's a doctrine, deathbed salvation. You're going to find deathbed salvation anywhere else. Everywhere else in the New Testament, there's a conversion. There's a repentance necessary. Deathbed salvation is found within the thief on the cross in the book of Luke's story. The thief on the cross supposedly repented in his last hours and was saved, and Jesus told him that he was saved. Okay, so if I accept the teachings of Jesus Christ, then I'm going to be able to escape this deathbed salvation false presentation of the thief on the cross. Now listen to me. The false presentation of the thief on the cross. Now no one else knows that this is a false presentation. I know, because I have accepted the teachings of Jesus Christ. In the mouth of two or three witnesses, let every word be established. Okay? Matthew and Mark says both thieves came against Jesus. Now, the thief on the cross says one thief didn't come against Jesus. That's one witness versus two witnesses, Matthew and Mark. So who do I choose? I choose Matthew and Mark, and then the thief on the cross in the book of Luke is a false doctrine. It's gone. It's out of there. So then I get to escape deathbed salvation, that false doctrine. And we see that very clearly. Actually, I had a pastor try to say, well, maybe there were three people crucified with Jesus. Well, no, John says there's one on either side, only two. So that's why I believe that the Bible is inspired. Because even with the corruptions and the errors, guys, you can escape the false doctrines. I did it. That's how I did it. That's why my presentations are so different from biblical Unitarian scholars. Because I'm presenting the way out without the scholarship. And it's kind of something that they're not prepared for, Trinitarians. Y'all bless those that are His.